103, 5 Lincoln 102. Lincoln 103 and 102.
Responding to 401 parking structure, section 1, boy.
Henry 8, Henry 9. Respond to gate 437, Bravo, for your dignitary detail. 3K911, unattended 400 lower level near Carousel 4, black bag. GTA in progress, 401 parking structure, section 4, boy.
Responding to 401 parking structure, section 1, boy.
415 passenger onboard aircraft.
Control 2, Franklin and Brown.
484 suspect, the female, Hispanic, 28 years of age. Blue G, no further.
Control, high Frank, 401 is a route.
Want to welcome you today to this edition of the Private Officer Beat Radio. I'm your host, Rick McCann, founder and CEO of Private Officer International, a private security and law enforcement association, and Armor College, a public safety and career college, and just a number of other companies that we have as well. And this morning, we're kind of still gathering a lot of information, intel, on this coronavirus. I am a certified EMT, paramedic, firefighter, law enforcement officer. I have been certified in this field for many, many years. I started out as an EMT in 1977, EMT firefighter in 1977. Certified to the same degree as any professional firefighter and paramedic, EMT, and law enforcement officer. And this coronavirus is something that has hit our country fast and furious. And many people are not taking it serious, but they should. All of the pandemic that's going on, all of the panic, all of the over-the-top things that's happening may be a little bit too much. But in all sincerity, there is reason to be concerned and reason to take this serious. Today, we're talking in our topic about the seriousness and how it's adversely and maybe in a little way positively affecting the private security industry. Now, the virus is airborne, and one little droplet from somebody's mouth or nose is all that it takes for you to catch it. And it is deadly, despite what many believe. It is something that can kill you. It is attacking mostly people from 50 and above. Some children have received it. But it is something to take very serious, and that's what our topic is going to be today, how it's affecting our industry. We have a lot of breaking news, of course. We do want to tell you a couple of things that have happened over the last couple of weeks that have really got us concerned, and that is, as you probably know, in Tennessee, in Nashville, Tennessee, two security officers were killed in the line of duty. Buildings collapsed on them during tornadoes. But what I have preached on year after year after year is these devastating storms, hurricanes, tornadoes, floods, and even just a common thunderstorm brings down power lines and trees, and many people are injured and killed during these events, and they are becoming more and more and more and more frequent. And we have to be prepared. Just about a month ago, in my subject matter here on the radio show, we talked about being prepared for all things. And I included devastating viruses and weather. And here we are right now dealing with these two very same topics. As security officers, we're on the front line. We're protecting the public, but we have to protect ourselves first. an injured or downed rescuer has never rescued anybody. You've got to be safe first. So in this current situation, with all these storms and now the virus, the coronavirus, spreading rapidly, are you prepared? Are you trained? Are you knowledgeable about these storms? What causes them? How quickly they come upon us and what the dangers are? Nashville was devastated shortly after 1 a.m. Central Time, just about, I guess it's been about 9 or 10 days ago now. And this happens not only in the Midwest, where people just think that it happens in Oklahoma and Kansas during the in the flat areas during the spring and fall. It happens in the South. It happens in the West. It even happens in the mountains. And so we have to be prepared. And tragically, security officers do lose their life every single year during these disasters, whether it be weather-related, man-made-related, or a virus. Now, we're going to talk about the coronavirus later on, but you need to know to stay safe, you should protect yourself. If you're going to be working in large crowds, concerts, or other venues, you should have gloves on. You should have a mask on. There's nothing to be ashamed of. Protect yourself, especially if you're 50 or above, or you have some type of immune system issue where you catch colds and flus frequently. Now, I'm getting older, and I have to recognize that, and I'm in that same position. I'm starting to get the flu several times a year, and this past year, right now, in January, February, I had it for almost 30 days. So it's something that we have to, as we grow older, be aware of and protect against. And if you're working on the front line in private security, law enforcement, public safety, EMS, fire service, whatever it might be, please take the necessary precautions. Wash your hands often. Stay away from large crowds. But if you have to work in them, be protected. Wear a N95 mask or above. Wear gloves. Protect yourself. And that way you can help others in these emergencies. Like I said, we have a lot of breaking news that we need to get to. And we have a few other topics that we need to cover today as well. But I'm very concerned that many people are not taking all of this coronavirus seriously. You know, it's not the end-all, be-all storm that some people are saying that it is, but it is to be taken serious, just like any other virus, any other flu, any other disease, especially one that we're not that familiar with and aren't that prepared for. And I just hope that you are taking it serious. I want to recognize Pat Mayers, Sergeant Pat Mayers of the Armour College Police, fantastic police officer, someone who's had years of experience with other full-time agencies. He has just been a real light for our department, and as we grow across state lines, we're going to be really needing people like him. We are hiring currently in many positions. We'll be talking about that coming up here in a few minutes. But you have an opportunity to work in law enforcement in a very unique department because we have officers in several states. And as we grow, like right now, we're going through a process in Alabama. We're going to be opening up a number of schools there, and we're definitely going to have a full statewide law enforcement agency there. So we are recruiting there right now for instructors and law enforcement, APO certified. We'll be talking more about that coming up in a few minutes. So much that we want to get to and so little time. Our radio programs actually go much longer than we really have time for, but we do cover a lot of different areas and breaking news. And I want you to send us at helpdesk@privateofficer.com anyone that you want to recognize, a coworker, a police officer, somebody in your community. You know, a number of months ago, we began an award program for frontline protectors, and we've included citizens who get involved. Recently in Jacksonville, Florida, a citizen saw a security officer struggling with a person outside of a liquor store, and he got involved. He helped the security officer to detain that suspect. So if you're in an area and you see a news item where a citizen has gotten involved, definitely let us know, because we want to recognize them with an award and get them in the newspaper. We want to make sure that they know that they are appreciated for their involvement. Same thing with law enforcement. We want you and your community to recognize law enforcement. So you be our eyes and ears, and we'll provide you with the tools to be able to recognize that officer, our frontline protectors. Same thing with private security. If you are the owner of a security company, a supervisor, just send an email to helpdesk@privateofficer.com with the person's name and information, and we'll recognize them. It won't cost you a nickel, not a penny. We're going to take our first quick break. When we come back, a whole lot of information, news, and, of course, more about the coronavirus coming up after these messages. Remember, if you're looking for body armor, you're looking for protective wear, you're looking for protective clothing, contact our friends at Body Armor USA. Body Armor USA, we've got what it takes to protect you. And if you're in the metropolitan Charlotte, North Carolina, South Carolina region, and you're looking for security officer training, the NCPPS North Carolina Unarmed or Armed, or the South Carolina SLED Training, contact our friend John over at Premier Training Academy right in the heart of Charlotte. Call him today or send him an email. Check him out online at Premier Training. John will be able to set you up for success, whether you're working security or EMS. He's got a lot of things that they offer over there. Premier Training, and that's John. Ask for John. We'll be right back after these messages.
My name's Melissa Kinsey, and I'm with the YMCA of Lincoln. Drowning can happen in an instant. Your kids need to be safe not only in the swimming pool, but at the lake, and even in the bathtub. So what you can do to keep your kids safe is to supervise them. Put down the phone, put down the book, and sit and watch. Sit and play. Put your swimming suit on, and make sure that your kids are always in view, and they will have a great summer.
Human trafficking is slavery.
And it happens all over America.
Any child, any woman, any man could potentially become a victim of human trafficking.
I am a victim of labor trafficking.
I was victim of child sex trafficking, but now I own my body.
Human trafficking is any kind of forced labor.
It can happen to anybody.
I am a mother.
I am an author.
I am a son.
I'm an advocate.
I am an educator.
I'm a sister.
I am a brother.
I'm so much more than what happened to me.
I am strong.
I am brave.
I am outspoken.
I am compassionate.
I am a survivor.
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 I am a survivor of human trafficking.
If you're not already receiving breaking news and our bi-weekly newsletter, Officer Don reports, and discount training news in your personal or business email, then go to our website right now at privateofficer.org. Privateofficer.org. A Dropbox will come down. Just fill out your info, and you'll be the first, one of the first, for sure, to know about what's happening in the security industry. You'll know when a security officer is killed. You'll also get these great discounts on training and equipment and so much more. PrivateOfficer.org. And if you're not already a member of the Private Officer International Association, sign up while you're there today. Become a lifetime member for just $99, and we'll also include a free Private Officer International patch and lapel pin.
If you are already a member, that's great, and we appreciate you. We'd like for you to spread the news and tell your coworkers, employees, and others in the industry about the Private Officer Group and how they can become a member and enjoy more than 40 member benefits.
I met Luke when I was pretty much born. We kind of just grew up together. He got his license when he was 16. We were going to the beach, and Luke was driving, and I was in the passenger seat. And all of a sudden, I don't remember anything. I wasn't conscious for it. We got hit by a drunk driver. I feel like I knew right away that it was never going to be the same. I don't know. The doctors, they were telling me I was so lucky to be alive. When I found out that he died on impact, I didn't really feel lucky. And sometimes I still don't. Drinking and driving is completely unnecessary, and I think it's selfish if you do it. It's just, it's not worth taking that risk, because you never know what's going to happen.
This week, we're also looking at some new training being made available for volunteer church security teams. This is coming out of Texas, the Attorney General Office for the state of Texas. That's Ken Paxton down there. He has come up with some informational guidelines and some training for volunteer security teams. You can access this page. Just go to texasattorneygeneral.gov/houses-worship. texasattorneygeneral.gov/houses-worship. Houses of Worship, volunteer security. This page gives you some information and some guidelines. It does not go into great detail about what you should or should not do. However, it will provide you with some legal resources, what the laws are currently in Texas, what they allow you to do and not do to protect houses of worship. They're providing some other resources on state and federal laws, and also discussing the Texas churches, synagogues, and other houses of worship organization and what the law now allows you to do. Just recently, the Texas state law passed that allowed their volunteer security teams to carry weapons inside the church. Now, I don't really understand, since we have separation of church and state, why that law was necessary. I've seen similar laws passed in recent years allowing security staff to carry guns inside the church, but you know, really, that's private property. It's like being at home or a business. But anyways, they did pass those laws. The Attorney General Ken Paxton, I guess, thought that he would get this page up to guide volunteer church security teams with what the laws are in Texas. Again, it really does not offer a lot of training. It's really not about that, although it says it's a training resource. I've looked through it, and it's generally talking about what the laws are in Texas, what it permits you to do, state and federally, what the laws cover, and also it talks a little bit about the volunteer security team's uniforms or a badge, if that's necessary. There are laws in Texas that regulate contract security officers, so if you are a contract security officer working for a contract security company, then yes, you have to register and be licensed through DPS, Department of Public Safety in Texas. You have to wear a uniform. You have to be identifiable. And in this resource being provided by the Attorney General's office, it's really going over what's required for volunteer members of the security team, whether or not they have to be uniform. Does the law require any special training for volunteer security team members? It kind of gives you a Q&A on that. And some other very general informational resources. Again, this is not a training website. When they first announced that this page was going up, it was made to sound like it was a training resource. And I thought, well, that's great, especially for volunteer security teams of small churches. I thought this was going to be a very helpful resource. And then when it was eventually published, we saw that it was really just a legal advisory and really didn't go into great detail at all. And it really doesn't cover training, just the legalities of what church security teams that are volunteers need to do and what's regulated and what is not regulated. Again, this is going to be on the website, texasattorneygeneral.gov/houses-worship. Houses of Worship. Go to the Attorney General's office in Texas if you're interested in this information. Go to their website. And it also gives you a phone number, of course, if you want to get more information, if you need further guidance, then you can call 1-800-621-0508. And again, this is from the Texas Attorney General's office. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, so much more that we want to talk about. We are going to get into the coronavirus and how it's affecting the private security industry. I think this is something that we need to understand a little bit deeper on how it's affecting this business and what you can expect over the next 60 days. I really want to, again, encourage you to find out more about this virus, how it's spreading, and also, you know, I caution you to take this serious. Of course, we don't want pandemonium. We don't want people to panic. And I've said that throughout the radio program already, but as a paramedic, as somebody in the EMS field, EMT, firefighter, law enforcement, I have worked among many different viruses. We get something like this every 3-4 years. And I just want you to be sure that you are prepared, that you have the knowledge necessary to keep safe and keep your family safe. And we're going to talk about how it's affecting the security industry. Coming up in just a few moments, we'll be right back after this break. Hey everyone, you're listening to the voice of the Frontline Protector right here on the Private Officer Radio Network. Now don't go away, because we are coming right back when we've got a whole lot more right here on the Private Officer Beat Radio.
Everyone, did you know that one organ donor can save up to 8 lives? The need for organ donors now is greater than ever. 120,000 people right now in the U.S. are waiting for an organ transplant. 95% of Americans support organ donation, but only a little over half are registered. My charity, Health Corps, has teamed up with Donate Life and Organize.org to save up to 500,000 lives by getting 62,500 folks to register as organ donors. If you're not registered, click the Register Now link to stand up and be counted. And when you're done, go on Facebook and tell us your story and add my hashtag organs will. For example, you might say, hashtag organs will make a difference. I'm an organ donor. Are you?
Another website that was launched recently that you may or may not be aware of is a school safety website. This is sponsored by the U.S. government, and their website is schoolsafety.gov, schoolsafety.gov. This was created by the federal government, the U.S. federal government, to provide security information for schools and school districts with actionable recommendations, it says, to create a safe and supportive learning environment where students can thrive and grow. Now, I've perused this website. There are numerous school safety topics and tips. Some of the areas include bullying and cyberbullying, threat assessment, and how to report threats that are occurring on school. There is an area that talks about school security personnel, physical security of the school campuses themselves. There's an area that talks about how important exercises and drills are, and training, proper training for staff and security personnel. It even covers topics such as mental health and emergency planning. Again, this is a pretty good website. Again, it's not really meant to give you training per se. It's not going to certify any security person to be a specialist in school security and safety, but it definitely gives you some basic level information and also provides some other links and resources that are available for schools and school security and safety teams. Again, that website is schoolsafety.gov, and I recommend that you check it out. It also talks about how to mitigate situations on campuses and prevent them before they even begin, as well as how a campus can recover after they do have a active shooter incident or other major event there at the school. It takes you through a action plan. You can take an assessment there and find other resources at schoolsafety.gov, schoolsafety.gov. There are also some upcoming training events, webinars. Looks like they are free and available to anyone, along with a page of other resource spotlight items and websites. Again, it sounds like a pretty good place to begin if you are working in school safety and security. Check them out at schoolsafety.gov. We have a lot going on. We do want to talk, of course, about the coronavirus and how it's really affecting currently the private security industry and how it's going to over the next few months. And we caution you not to panic. We're going to bring up a lot of good, useful information for you and some resources. And be sure that you share this with coworkers and team members and as well as management team. And don't forget, if you are an instructor certified in the state of Virginia, the state of North Carolina, South Carolina, Tennessee, Georgia, if you are a security instructor, a firearms instructor, we have openings. We have positions, full-time and contracted instructors. Send an email with your resume to Carrie, C-A-R-R-I-E, at Armour, A-R-M-O-U-R, college.org. We also have openings for lifeguard instructors, CPR, first aid instructors, including those who instruct instructors, train the trainer. Positions available. Currently in Alabama, we are looking for a A-post certified law enforcement officer. Must be academy certified and certified by the state of Alabama, A-post certified. If you are currently or previously a law enforcement officer, please send your resume to Carrie at Armour,
armorcollege.org. Also, we have other positions. Check them out online at armorcollege.org or send your resume today. And don't forget, we're also expanding. If you are looking for a fantastic business opportunity, then check out armorcollege.org. We are expanding rapidly across the country, a very unique public safety college, public safety and career, recognized numerous times in the media. We've been interviewed by the media over the last 5 years. Our school now celebrating 10 years. And prior to that, we had another public safety school with 4 locations. But this is an opportunity. If you are an instructor or somebody looking for a unique type of business, you don't have to be college educated. You don't have to be somebody who's been an academy instructor for 3,500 years. You know, we can train you in our system. We offer all instructor certifications, front office and business support, legal support, administrative support. It's a turnkey operation. All that you have to do is instruct and manage your business. In business for yourself, but not by yourself, really is our model. Contact Carrie, C-A-R-R-I-E, at Armour, A-R-M-O-U-R, college.org. Our team will contact you immediately and walk you through the process. We're going to take another quick break. When we come back, we've got a lot more to say, a lot of breaking news, and we want to talk about how the coronavirus is affecting the private security industry.
Without this woman, my father couldn't have had his hip replaced.
Without these people, I'd be dead.
This man helped my son through leukemia.
Do something amazing. Give blood.
The news desk at this time. We're looking at some breaking news coming in to our office. It looks like the President of the United States will be having a conference, televised conference, later in the day. I'm pretty sure this has something to do with declaring a national state of emergency type thing, but we will stay on top of it. We're looking at some more breaking news coming in, but we will stay on top of it and bring you the latest as soon as we know. Coming out of South Carolina, in Gaffney, South Carolina, that's somewhere close to Spartanburg, Greenville, Limestone College, which is a private college in South Carolina, has decided to create its own police force. Now, currently, they do have a private public safety unit, and they do have arrest authority on the property. The Board of Trustees said they voted to begin the process to have a SLED, South Carolina Law Enforcement Division, certified police force because it will give them more access to training and police databases and other things that they need to be able to protect their students and staff. Now, that's a pretty small college, about 3,000 people, but we are seeing more and more schools, including our own, that are forming their own police department. In Teller County, Colorado, the sheriff there, Jason Mikesell, is under scrutiny right now because he owns a security company called IXERO LLC. He's been using a lot of the law enforcement, sheriff's department resources to expand his security company even to the West Coast, where he just got a $3.5 million contract with a school system. Some of the people in the community say that he is working his security business along with his sheriff duties. And he responded by saying that law enforcement is never off duty. They're on duty 24/7, so it's impossible for him to be working his security job at the same time that he is working law enforcement because, you know, they're on duty all the time. Two people in Palm Beach were arrested. They were from Canada. They were trespassing at Mar-a-Lago and the president's property there. And they were taken into custody. Aaron Menny, 62, and Catherine Poon, 54, had been on the property earlier. Law enforcement was called and told them to leave the property. They returned at about 12:20 p.m., and security had detained them, and the sheriff's department arrested them for criminal trespassing. A New Orleans security officer was able to detain a bank robbery suspect at the Central Business District Tuesday afternoon. Authorities there say that the teller gave some type of notification to security that they were being robbed. The bank, located at 600 block of Padre Street, downtown in the business district, the security officer quickly responded, was able to detain Joseph Cooks, 33, notify law enforcement, and he was arrested for attempted armed bank robbery. Coming out of Madison, Wisconsin, at the Easttown Mall, a security officer was battered and assaulted by shoplifters, and unfortunately, the security officer was injured, and the shoplifter got away. This case remains under investigation. Also coming out of Wisconsin, Milwaukee police say that a Milwaukee father was assaulted by an unlicensed private security officer at the Buffalo Wild Wings at Bayshore, and that he was pepper sprayed, and the security officer is being sued. The restaurant is being sued, and police now are re-looking at this case as an assault. Now, the security officer was arrested for multiple charges. He had previously been arrested for carrying a gun while intoxicated and other charges. So we're going to be following this in our Court Watch segment, where we have staffers that continuously update cases just like this. In Waterloo, Iowa this week, several men ambushed an armored truck at a bank. Police there say that the men ambushed the armored car security officers from Rochester Armored Truck outside of the U.S. Bank in a robbery attempt. A gunfire, really it was an all-out war. The bad men and the security officers both got into a gun battle. And unfortunately, one of the robbers died, and security was fine. So that's the way that it should be. And police are still looking for the other subjects that were involved. Also in the news this week, an Austin man is he has been sentenced to 92 months in prison for assaulting a TSA officer. The Austin man was at the Austin Bergstrom International Airport last year when he assaulted the TSA officer. The federal court judge gave him 92 months in prison. Now, in federal court, when we're talking about sentencing, in federal prison, you serve day for day. There is no good time. There is no early out. He'll be there for almost 10 years. In Ellis County, Texas, a shooting involving security, a suspect, and several others at the 780 Sports Club. Security was injured. The man's on the run right now. and it's under investigation. Coming out of Perry County, this was in Indiana, a Perry County Detention Center correctional officer employed by the Sheriff's Department has been arrested for smuggling. Julia Naomi Allen, 25, was arrested by the Tell City Police Department Monday for smuggling contraband into the jail. This is a felony. We see this, unfortunately, occur quite often. In Nashville, Tennessee, police say a security officer assisted law enforcement in apprehending Larry B. Farmer, 23, who threatened to kill a person. Police responded to the area of Buena Vista community, and the security officer on duty assisted in apprehending this armed felon. Speaking of armed felons, a Hagerstown, Maryland security guard this week was arrested at the Dagmar Hotel. He was a convicted felon who shot two people at the hotel while on duty. Gregory Ricardo Thirault, the second, 26 years of age, has been charged with that shooting. He admitted to law enforcement when they arrived that he was a felon. He should not be in possession of a gun, but a confrontation ensued, and he fired and shot both men. They are currently in the hospital and doing all right. Police say that a woman tried to stab a security officer at a Bronx, New York Family Dollar store. Authorities are currently searching for that woman. This happened at the Family Dollar store on Ogden Avenue and West 166th Street. Police say that she sold a number of items, and when a uniformed security officer tried to stop her at the door, they had a physical confrontation, and she attempted to stab the security officer. Also talking about shoplifting, in Palm Coast, Florida, a 60-year-old man at a Publix grocery store tried to steal some items, and when approached by the security officer, he claimed he was a U.S. Marshal. He even took out a badge. It was similar to a TV prop, and showed that badge that said United States Marshal. He was taken into custody for impersonating a law enforcement officer as well as theft. In Virginia, at the Mary Baldwin University, there was a robbery on campus, according to the Stoughton Police Department. Tyreek I. Brandon, 18, has been arrested by the Richmond City Police Department and charged with that robbery, grand larceny, use of a firearm in the commission of a felony, breaking and entering with intent to rob. Campus security responded initially and notified city police for backup. They were able to identify the suspect in this case, and another agency did arrest that suspect shortly thereafter. It looks like that in Virginia, there will be at least five cities that will have casinos. A law is all but done with and going to be signed by the governor. Virginia Senate Law 2712 will allow Portsmouth, Richmond, Norfolk, Danville, and Bristol to have casinos operated by one of the tribal authorities there. And they already have some off-track betting locations, and plenty of security opportunities will come of it, I'm sure. A Michigan man initially found guilty in a security officer's death was acquitted this week in Wayne County, Michigan. Carl Rene Bruner II was found not guilty following his second trial in connection with the shooting of Marcel Jackson, 39, a security officer that was shot on June 20th. And after this appeal and second trial, he has been found not guilty. An alert Colorado security officer is being praised by local police after he spotted a burglary in progress, notified the Pueblo, Colorado Police Department. They arrived and together was able to track down the suspect. He did take off, but they were able to apprehend him a short time later. 23-year-old Raymond Ray has been arrested for burglary, possession of burglary tools, criminal trespass in the first degree, and he had two outstanding warrants. Like I was saying, you know, there's always a lot of news. So if you're not already receiving our breaking news alerts, Sign up today at privateofficer.org. Privateofficer.org. They are free. Private Officer News. We operate 24/7. We're always checking news. More than 2,500 news feeds, and you'll be the first, almost the first. You'll probably be the second person that will know what's happening, along with Officer Down reports and upcoming training events. Go to our website, privateofficer.org. You do not have to be a member. It's free to anyone. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we got a whole lot more going on.
What am I doing lying in this casket? Oh, yeah. That's right. I'm dead. I got shot. I'm not supposed to be dead. I'm only 17. And now I can't see my 18th birthday because I'm a fatal victim of gun violence. My friends, my family, my own mother was devastated. Can't see her son anymore because of gun violence. And everyone's here at the funeral. But before they lay me to rest, there's just one last thing I have to do. How many more of us have to die from gun violence? Let's put a stop to this, because if we don't, the next time it could be your child lying in this casket.
Some of you may be old enough to remember the SARS virus, S-A-R-S, SARS virus, that came around a number of years ago. The SARS virus was a strain or type of virus similar to the coronavirus that we are experiencing today. And every 3, 5, 10 years, we get some type of virus. We get the bird flu, we get the bird virus, we get this, we get that. And it is something that you need to take serious. Yes, thousands of people die from the flu every year. That's a fact. And tens of thousands of others get the flu. And that's a fact. The difference between the current coronavirus, which is a strain of the SARS virus, and the flu is three things. Number one, there's no way to prevent it. There's no way to fight against it. Currently, we don't have any antivirus. It's not like a flu where you can take a flu shot and hopefully be shielded from contacting the flu. Number two, the coronavirus, because it was mostly unknown here in the U.S., came upon us suddenly. So while many people are complaining about not having enough tests, not being able to adequately be screened, understand that this is all brand new, and it wasn't like this is a virus that the U.S. was familiar with and had a stockpile of tests and antivirus and ways to fight this immediately within 24 hours. They had to secure the test from other suppliers and countries, and they've had to teach medical professionals about what the virus is and what it isn't, how to prevent it, how to fight it, how to treat it. This is not an overnight process. As a paramedic and an EMT and a firefighter since 1977, I know for a fact that is just not possible to solve a disease or a virus or an illness overnight. It takes a lot of time to develop antivirus serums, and once you find out what it is exactly, once you find out what's involved, then you start developing a way to fight it, and you don't produce product of any type. Let's say you needed 40 million tires tomorrow. No
tire supplier could guarantee they could send you, even in a week or a month from now, 40 million tires. Well, all of a sudden we need 40 million or 20 million tests the virus. And the supplier is not going to be able, no matter how many employees they have, to rev up the manufacturing of these test kits. Now, in China, they said they built a hotel in a day or two that housed all of those who had contacted the virus. Well, guess what happened to that hotel? It collapsed. And dozens of people were killed and more were injured because they tried to do it too fast, too quick, and they didn't do it properly. So to develop a product such as a test, first you have to know what you're testing for and what are the testing methods. In some cases, the testing methods is a blood test. In some cases, it is an analysis of one's breath. In another situation, it might be that they need to send it off to the lab. Now, I am familiar with LabCorp, a very large corporation that does a whole lot of different testing, screenings. They're one of our suppliers for drug testing, and they are testing now for the coronavirus, but even they had to ramp up over several weeks, not several hours or several days. Now, this is affecting our country and the world alike and will for several more months, I'm sure, well into probably June and July, possibly even the end of the summer. But it's like a flu. It will come through and it will move out just like the flu. But it is affecting the private security industry as well, because obviously security officers like law enforcement and EMS and public safety are part of our community, part of our population. So as I mentioned earlier, 11 security officers that we know of have been confirmed to have the coronavirus, including 3 TSA, two New York City security officers, one worked at a Broadway theater, and one worked at a museum, and several others in California and Texas have been screened and have the virus. This is something that we have to understand as a industry that works with the public, that we are more acceptable to receiving this, to acquiring this virus than the average Joe that might work in a three-man or a five-person company. Private security are on the front line every single day, whether they are working at a factory, whether they are at a gatehouse checking people in and out, they're coming in contact with the public. And as such, are more receptive to receiving and contracting that disease. As more and more states shut down commercial venues, concerts, theaters, sporting events, and even schools across the country, universities are closing, private security will still be on duty in many of those events, many of those businesses. Many of those locations, they'll still be on the front line. There may not be any people there or very few people, but they are still going to be on the front line. And they still could come in contact with the disease with the few people that they have contact with. Now, many of our security personnel use public transportation, light rail, buses, Uber, and other car services to get to and from their assignment. And again, this will open up that possibility of getting that virus, the coronavirus. So the security industry, it may actually, you know, get business during this time, but it's also going to lose business. Take an arena that has 100 or more events scheduled throughout the year, and now for 2 or 3 months they have no events. They don't need 15 security officers. They don't need 30 security officers for that event or those events. So now more security officers will be laid off. More security officers will not make the income that they have planned on and that is necessary to support their household. There are many, many situations developing even as we are on this radio show today. We just heard that fast food restaurants like McDonald's and KFC and others, they are developing some type of program for their employees to prevent them from acquiring this disease, this virus. And it may be that they're all going to wear masks and gloves, and it may be that they only will have drive-through. And I know for a fact that several restaurants in our area, my area, has gone to drive-through only. So we may see all restaurants shut down and only offer some type of drive-through or delivery service, as our companies here, POI, Armor, and others, we use a lot of delivery services for our office supplies, waters, bottled water, things like that. And it may be that all stores, all retailers, all restaurants may just go to a delivery service or a drive-through service. This affects private security because, you know, they were working at the store and now they're unemployed because they're not working in the drive-through line. They're not working in delivery. So you can really see a lot of people being affected by this in the security field. Some might be good because there might be more jobs in some areas, more positions. And in others, there'll be less positions, depending on what area of the security industry that you work in. Let's say that you work for Walmart or Target or another big box in loss prevention, or you are a door greeter. Guess what? If the stores close down and only go to delivery only or some type of drive-through situation, loss prevention would be laid off 2 to 3 months or more. So it will affect the security industry, and it has affected the security industry. Right now, we have a number of security officers, a large number of security officers, in six states. Six states so far have completely shut down their schools until further notice. In some states, they've shut them down for 1 month. In other states, until further notice. This situation is affecting security instructors and schools as well. We have some schools that will not be able to instruct students. There'll be no need to instruct new security officers because security officers are being laid off. It will affect instructors who make their living, like some of my staff, instructing every single day. Luckily for us, the positive is that security instruction for our schools is just a percentage of what we do. So we'll continue on with our other courses, and we have many courses and programs that are online. So as with many colleges and universities across the country, we'll continue online as well as in person. There are a lot of things that's really, I think, still coming in the next few days and weeks that will affect security. Some stores may call for armed security. Locations may still operate 24 hours a day and need security for crowd control. Maybe even traffic control. I went into our local Sam's Club yesterday. There was a limit on toilet paper and paper towels and cleaning supplies and bottled water. Two each day per customer. Even though we're Sam's Club members and business members, we were still limited. Same thing with Costco. I thought I'd drive around the corner over to the Costco. Same thing. Limits. So we may have a situation where armed security may have to be called in for crowd control. I have been in cities where there were riots. I've lived in areas where there were brownouts. I've lived in areas that had natural disasters where security was the front line and they were called in to keep the peace, to stop theft, to direct traffic and traffic control. And we may have that scenario sooner than later. This is affecting private security in many, many ways, and I don't even think that we've scratched the surface yet. Private police officers are also being called in to control chaos in Washington, D.C., where they have thousands of private police officers. They've been called into some store, Safeway, to control the public and to keep the peace. We have yet to see, I think, the magnitude of the pandemonium and the panic. But thankfully, you know, I do believe the doctors and the professionals who believe that this will be done and gone, you know, within a few months, 3-4 months at the most. And hopefully that it will, and hopefully with few fatalities from it. Again, if you have to work out in the environment where you're going to be within a crowd of people, be sure to have a mask on and gloves. You need to protect yourself and take this serious. It is fatal for people who are 50 and above. It is fatal with people who have certain medical conditions. A lot of people have medical conditions that they don't even know. People die every day of heart attacks, and they never knew they had a heart condition, or they had high blood pressure. So take care of yourself. And there are some free medical screenings in some cities. Free. Take the time to go get tested for the coronavirus. We're going to update you as more information becomes available. Be sure to be monitoring our emails, our news blog. Our news emails, if you're not receiving them, go to our website at privateofficer.org. Sign up for breaking news and news alerts today. They're free. And follow our news blog on the web, Blogspot, privateofficernews.blogspot.com. That's all for today. Be safe. Take extra precautions. Be blessed, and we'll see you back here on the radio. Thank you.